purchased quite a few old maps, starting in, I believe it was 1854, to show how the town developed. 1844. I have an 1844 map, 1861, an 1860. These are all DVDs. And they're very interesting to see how portions of the towns developed, and then you can see dots where the houses were and where the industrialization was around the streams and rivers. Like you said, the forge was over at Forge Pond, which empties into Bachelor Brook, and that follows parallel to Bachelor Street, or Bachelor Street follows parallel to that. And that's where you had your paper mills, your grist mills, your sawmills, and they used the water in order to power a lot of the equipment.
And the Aldridge Mill that's on the back of the Granby High School t-shirt, all-class reunion that was held yesterday up in Hadley. That, contrary to what it says in the Bicentennial book, it doesn't mention it, but most people don't realize that was used to generate electricity for the trolley in their earlier days.
Yes, when Mr. Aldridge came back from being a civil engineer in New York, he came back to town, took over the family homestead over on Aldridge Street, and he's the one that put the dam in to hold the water back, and he put an offshoot system that doesn't go down over the dam. It comes through a pipe in order to run the wheel, and he's the one that developed the electricity on that side of town. And I found an article in an old newspaper. I subscribe to old newspapers. And he was actually called to task from the electric company. They didn't like him producing the electricity. And he took it to the select board. And they said, no, he's allowed to do it. But he provided the energy to do the trolley over the notch.
Right. And he was actually, Eldridge Aldridge was the grand marshal for the 1968 200. Bicentennial Parade.
Yes, he was.
And he had a nice top hat, and there's pictures and records that you can find at the Historical Society on that as well.
Yep.
And, of course, donated the land for where the public safety complex is right now in town.
He did.
And Aldridge Hall, so a lot of history there.
Yeah.
Granby philanthropist.
Yes, yes. He did a lot for even the children in town. He's the one that developed. There used to be a roller skating rink and dancing pavilion on Aldridge Lake, and canoes, and then of course it was turned over to the Boy Scouts for a while, and they had the Boy Scout camp there. But he's a very interesting fella. He just did a lot for Granby.
Yeah, of which why there was a trolley tracks there for the demand for the people getting out of the city for the weekends to and they had big dances there, I heard, mm-hmm. on Friday, Saturday nights.
Yeah.
So this is all prior to the Boy Scout camp that was
yes.
up there.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And, he even has a few patents at the Library of Congress. So I can't quite remember what it was, but if you look it up, the Library of Congress has all these old maps that you can get. And you look up Aldridge and you look up the mill and you'll find it in the Library of Congress.
Yeah, and also we're waiting for the start of the parade. You really shouldn't ever take for granted when you drive through the town common, because it's a quintessential New England town, and you go out west with these towns that aren't as old as ours. You gotta never take that for granted. It is a beautiful, and that church has been well photographed and painted, especially during the fall, nice fall foliage. So we've got a wonderful, beautiful town common, and a lot of stone walls, a lot of architecture,
a
lot of old houses, a lot of history in town, and it should be passed on. So, you know, from 50 years from now, when someone watches this coverage of the parade, they'll probably be saying, well, what primitive technology they have.
But
we've come a long way, because in 1968 there was absolutely no coverage, and on TV there was four stations back then, and with antennas, and now with the advent of the internet and cable TV, we've grown quite a bit in that area.
Well, interesting about the town common, it is one of it was described in our planning and survey grant as one of the most original town commons in this area, meaning that most of the houses are still there. There's very few that have been taken down. Of course, some of them were subject to fire and then rebuilt. Some of them are not the original houses, but they still date pretty far back. I think the only one that's in the 1900s is the Brooks House, and it's described as a ranch. But most of the others are circa 17 to 1800s.
And before John Center Pharmacy, there was a gas station there.
Yes,
in the
they
center
had pumps
of town,
in the front.
And also the flatness of it before 202 was built
yes.
to accommodate the traffic. In the earlier days, it was horse and buggies. It was a very flat area and spread out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think mm-hmm. you said why they chose to put the Kellogg Hall in the
well
church was up on a hill back
yes.
then. It was much more on a hill. It wasn't laid out the way it is now.
Right. The other thing about West Street was not there in the earlier years of Granby, as far as West Street ended at Crescent Street, and then that's how you got to the center of town, is via Crescent Street. And you got on to what is now 202, you went down Parish Hill Road, and that was part of somebody's farm.
And looking back at the records, there was also a lot of districts for schools. So some people went to school in Ludlow, some people went to Chicopee, some people went to South Hadley. It was different times, but they did also spend an awful lot of money and recognize the value of an education back in even those days.
So here we have the start of our parade. We have the first.
Oh, friends of ours.
Yes, friends of
Granby
of
Community Granby. Access and Media. And we've got, looks like Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts. I don't know the Girl Scouts name, but we have Boy Scouts Abe Gould and Matt Guncars rolling and bowling candy and magnets to the patrons on the side of the committee. On the camera is our own Jen Silva, our clerk of the board of directors. Inside is Herb Abelson, Dr. Herb Abelson, and his wife. And we hope you all enjoy the parade. Something done a little different in coverage. We've got a camera to show patrons on both sides of the parade route.
So give them a wave. Okay. The next thing that we have...
Sponsors. We have
sponsors.
Naraki Construction, Western Builders, Florence Savings Bank, Granby Auto Body, and what is the other? Dennis LaFleur.
From Happy Days.
Yeah, and we've got also... Here's our parade committee. We have Micheline Turgeon, Linda Fish, Richie Gage riding in the golf cart, Mike Simpson, Deb Matthew, Amy Gay, and Tammy Bilbo.
And next we have our first fire truck that was acquired in 1938. That's when the fire department started. And the chief at that time was Robert Dressel. We have Wallace Bray, Ray Dickinson, William Gallup, Alden Blake, Valmore Loisel, George Bell, Henry Sombrowski, and various others. Our next float is...
Well, we've got to go back to our parade marshal, George Randall. He's resided in town for 68 years, member of the 250th Celebration Committee, former Boy Scout, former Lion, former town moderator, retired 34-year member of the Granby Fire Department, was secretary treasurer of the Firefighters Association for 25 years. And he wants us to say that he's got an upcoming program on GCAM called Conversations with George. He'll soon be interviewing the town government. He wants to say thank you, everyone, for coming out today and being part of this wonderful event.
And we had the Granby Board of Selectmen just go by with Steve Shinaki and Glenn Sexton. And, of course, we have a new one. His name is Jay Joyce.
And we've got State Senator Eric Lesser, elected to Mass Senate. He's one of the youngest senators in the state, representing the first Hamden and Hampshire District, party representing Western Mass. He lives in Longmeadow, just blocks from where he grew up with his wife Allison, two young daughters, Rose and Nora, and a family dog named Cooper. Also retiring state Granby rep, John Skyback.
We also have John Hine from South Hadley. I believe he ran for state rep for Massachusetts, and he's been a select board on many other offices in the town of South Hadley. Now we have Ms. Granby, 2018. That is Sydney Cordair, is riding in the 1951 Studebaker owned by Gene Caswell. And we also have the 2018 Colleens, riding in the Cadillac Eldorado, 1971. They are Samantha Judicki, Megan Jolivet, Carol Gould, Lindsay Nobes, Brooklyn Barron, all riding in that beautiful 1971 Cadillac.
And just to mention that here is 1968, Queen in her court was Suzanne Trompke White, Nancy Zucker Janensko, Patty Marcotte Cotis.
We had a couple of people that are the Gold Cane citizens of Granby. They are Gordon Davey for the men, he's 95. And we have the Granby Silver Cane for the women, and that is Ethel P. Donahue, and she is 97. Here are the beard contestants. No, that's not the, who's
no, winners.
We have the Granby Junior Senior High Band accompanied by the East Meadow School that represents grades 4 through 12. Next we have the Granby School Department,
which is Emery Everin, Michael Simpson, Jennifer Curran, Jennifer Bartos, and Lynn Payne Ruskowski.
Is that Brandy Dumas, the winner of the East Meadow School Granby Flag Contest?
Yes.
And the Granby School alumni are now coming up.
Yeah, and Betsy Ross says nothing on 12-year-old Brandy Dumas, says Lisa Redmond from the Turley Publications Belchtown Sentinel. She was one of 140 designs at East Meadow School, and the Board of Selectmen chose the winner. Congratulations to Brandy.
Now you can tell who the Granby alumni are by their blue t-shirts. And on the front they have the Granby Rams. And on the back they have the water wheel, the Aldridge water wheel.
And we've got the Granby Lions Club. Happy 65th birthday to the Granby Lions Club. Was chartered in 1953 and have been serving the community of Granby for 65 years. The Lions began as an organization in 1917. Melvin Jones wanted to call this new organization the Lions, which stood for liberty, intelligence, our nation's safety. I've been privileged to serve for the past 27 years with several fine Lions, and thank you, Lions.
Okay, we just had go by the Massachusetts Volunteer Militia and the 12th Georgia Infantry. And here we have some of the people from the American Legion. Originally, the American Legion in Granby started after World War II, and we had George Haino Sr., who helped develop the American Legion first in Kellogg Hall. They used to use the old tax collector's office, and they had a bar in there, and they were allowed to join in.
And the Friends of the Granby Veterans, Granby sold. We've had French Indian Wars, Revolutionary War, Shays Rebellion, War of 1812, Civil War, World War I, World War II, Korean War and Vietnam War, Middle East conflicts. We want to honor all those heroes and their supporting friends and neighbors and family.
Next is the Granby Preservation Society. They have a depiction of Kellogg Hall, which they are trying to restore. And the many things on the float depict all of the different organizations that use the Kellogg Hall. So it was a school, it was an American Legion, it was a civil defense.
Police department, kindergarten. And there's Mr. Kellogg in costume, along with a librarian and school teacher.
Mr. Kellogg, of course, was the one that donated the property and some of the money.
And here's a beautiful
ferry.
Here's
the Granby Historical Association. We have Sammy White driving the horses. And we have members of the Granby Historical Association board seated in garb of the era. Next, we have Terry Johnson, who is the Pooper Scooper.
President of the Historical Society and Immaculate Heart of Mary Church.
The Immaculate Heart of Mary Women's and Men's Group. Okay. There is a car coming up for the Immaculate Heart of Mary, and in it are, I believe it's the DeWitts. I mean, not the DeWitts, the Danettes. Mr. Danette was just recently recognized as very instrumental in the church organization. And this Immaculate Heart of Mary float looks like the original from 1968, where they depicted the building. I don't know if that is the original building that they used on the 1968 float, but it looks very similar.
Nice job, very beautiful. And here comes the Church of Christ with period costumes. The theme of the float is then and now. Just wanted to be noted that they recently voted to be an open and affirming church welcoming the LGBTQ community and people of all differences. Wonderful looking float.
Okay, next we have, I'm not real sure who this is, Larry. Can you read the side of, is this Red Fire Farm?
No, I cannot.
This is the
Helping Neighbors.
Neighbors Helping Neighbors.
It's the South Hadley Falls-based food pantry. Thank you for participating.
Okay, next we have the Granby Boy Scout Troop 306 with their rock climbing wall float. There are many, many different organizations within the Boy Scouts, like the Lion Cubs and the Tiger Cubs and Weeblos, and they have a website, and they're looking for members.
There's GCAM member Jack Marcy waving, and also Scoutmaster Scott Weatherby. And the Boy Scouts have been around in Granby since 1935, and the girls since 1937.
And here's your Granby Cub Scout pack, 4034. And again, take a look at their website. They have plenty of activities to keep your children busy. And you can see they're having a great time.
Here comes a lot of members and active members of the Granby Athletic Association, which was began in 1957 in Granby. Against the backdrop of significant world events, a group of civic-minded citizens began planning organized sports for boys and girls at Granby. They have baseball, basketball, wrestling, and the first president was Hank Henry Ziomek. Vice president was Warren Cook. The Lions Club helped donate money, and the highway department much-needed assistance to build a little league field on the corner of West and Crescent Street. Which was part of the greatest generation. We thank all of those volunteers in those days to give Granby children that type of sports fun.
Next we have the McDuffie School.
The leader of the school, Steve Griffith, mentioned that he wants to wish Granby a happy 250th birthday and hope that he's in Granby for another 250 years. They moved from their Springfield 1890, they began in Springfield. They moved the campus to Granby in 2011. And he also wanted me to mention that they are the largest privately employer in town.
The Brooks Real Estate just went by. That began in 1960 as a Brooks agency. The origins have a deep history with Granby, being founded in 1938 by Henry King and Esther McCool as the King McCool Insurance Agency.
And Cindy's Drive-In, which has a world-famous footlong hot dog, hard and soft ice cream, a very colorful float. Makes me want to go over there and grab a milkshake, doesn't it?
Yes, they purchased the drive-in in 1995, and you can go past them on any given night, and there are over 50 cars. They have a lot of car shows as well, so bring your historic car down there. Next, we have the Belchertown 4-H Garden Club.
Roll me over. Here's the Belchertown Incredible Clovers.
That's another 4-H group, another good organization to keep your kids busy. They have animal husbandry. They have gardening, horses.
Anna, Children's First.
Children's First is a child care organization that is down near Five Corners. It's run by Donna Danette. They have about 90 children that go to school there in the morning while their parents are off to work.
And here's the Chicopee Sportsman's Club, President Renee Thompson, established in 1938 and 500 beautiful acres of woodlands. As a club for all outdoors with plenty of room for outdoor activities. They have summer outings held in a large pavilion and outdoor picnic area. They have trout stocked in the pond. Very nice. Here comes Smokey the Bear.
Yes, this is the DCR Forest Fire Control Fire District 10. Smokey, if you want your children to learn about fire control and how to prevent fires, they have a website that you can go on and possibly present a program to some of the children in town.
And here's the Fairview Sportsman's Club with President Tom Anderson. They were established in Granby in 1934, relocated. They were established in 1934, relocated to Granby in 1964 from Chicopee, and they have a very active club as well. Looks like we've got a souped up 19, I don't know what year that is. That isn't a 74 Plymouth.
Martin Automotive. A roadster, maybe that one. Very nice.
Well, we can recognize the aqua color of the 57 Chevy, followed by the Pioneer Valley GTO Society, always a classic hot rod car from the monster years of the muscle cars, excuse me, of the 60s and 70s.
Pontiacs, Oldsmobiles.
When a car was a car, you could actually come out of the supermarket and find it. Didn't blend in like the rest of them.
We thank a lot of these people in these cars because they are keeping a part of history alive from an automotive perspective. Beautiful cars. And you can tell they really love their cars and they take care of them very well. All these are GTOs, huh, Larry? Yeah. Oldsmobiles,
Pontiacs. Here comes
Pontiacs.
The Zumba. You're going to mention something about
yes.
The Zumba.
The Zumba Group. They are located on 202 just next to Brooks Insurance. They took over what used to be a consignment shop, and you can go there and get your exercise in.
Here comes Brian Hostel, former selectman, with a 1958 Corvette. And behind him is his son, Jarrett, with a 19...
It's got to be a 50-something.
Yeah, it's a Ford F1, 1948, just
48.
Freshly restored.
Very nice. Very nice. And here's Tom Benson, Stump Begone Ford Truck.
He's an independent landscape contractor from Harris Street. We appreciate the history of that old vehicle. I'm sure it did some work in somebody's town a few years ago. And a contingent of Hampshire towing tow trucks. Yellow lights are flashing.
Those are some kind of towing trucks. And following up behind the Hampshire towing trucks, we have Bill and Tracy Johnson in a 66 Ford Fairlane. Of course, all these beautiful trucks in front of the Fairlane are part of the Johnson fleet.
And is this the Saddle Club?
Early Mug.
Early Mug, oh.
This is the Early Mug horse-drawn wagon. Of course, the Early Mug is run by the Poitras sisters, which is Cindy Monnier and Earlene Poitras. And they took over the old Dufresne restaurant and Meany's restaurant, and they are now a breakfast and lunch and brunch facility.
I know Crystal from the Beers and Story Funeral Home. Went on a cruise with her once, and a foreign bartender said, you know, what do you do for a living? You know, the waiter said, well, you're a bartender? No, I'm an embalmer. They couldn't understand the difference between an embalmer and a bartender.
And here we have an old coffin being taken by an old hearse. Very beautiful, beautiful piece of equipment.
And a 1938 Plymouth coupe.
And is this the Model A?
Yeah, that's a Model A.
Yeah.
A lot of nice antique
beautiful
cars.
Nice antique cars.
And some more antique cars and classic cars.
Nice. Very nice. Look at the rumble seat.
Sure.
They got their cooler in the back there.
Yes. A vintage cooler, too. Metal.
Yes.
Painted freshly. Nice Mustang. Plymouth.
Is that a Dodge? Plymouth?
That's a Plymouth, yeah.
Plymouth? Yes.
Now you got a Chevy, bright red, taken out only on parade days.
Yeah, they really take care of their vehicles. Is this a
Chevy?
That's a
65,
Chevy.
65, I'm guessing. Could be 64, okay. And there's an El Camino.
El Camino,
yeah,
yes.
That is a...
You don't see many of those anymore.
No.
I don't think they really made too many of those either.
Getting back to the Granby's Rich Farm, there's a nice replica of a blue and white honoring Granby with, I see Lance Humphrey on there. I'm not sure who else is waving a flag, but that's wonderful. And we've got a VW.
This is the Lucky Horse Farm.
Okay, the Lucky Horse Farm. No, Granby Saddle Club. Yeah, yep. Granby Saddle Club. And being that Granby is a rich town in regards to horses, whose industry is based in part of, on the horse trade. Large volumes of horses that were used primarily for agriculture and the distribution of products were sold through the Meadowcraft Farm in Granby during the 1930s. These horses were purchased by the rail car load and delivered to Hoyoke and Belchertown. From there, the horses were hand walked or driven down the major roadways to Granby. Farmers from throughout Connecticut River Valley relied upon the consistent source of horsepower that was provided by the Hatch family at the Meadowcroft Farm in Granby.
Here we have, representing the Granby Saddle Club, is Shana Humphrey on her horse Sierra and Teresa Naz on Call Me Larry. The Granby Saddle Club is dedicated to providing horse riding events and maintenance of riding trails in and around Dufresne Park. The Saddle Club is an organization that has concerns of the local horse community at heart. Shows provide great first-time experiences for horses and their riders and stimulates and stimulates to the horse community here in Granby.
She's also an Olympic rider. Congratulations for her success. And getting back to Granby being a rich horse town, it's one of the few towns that has an excise tax placed on the value of horses that still exists today. It's one of the only remaining towns in the Commonwealth of Mass that taxes horses. $5 per every $1,000 of value is collected by the town annually. Today, Granby boasts one of the highest ratios of horses to the people in the Commonwealth.
Hello,
205 horses reside on Taylor Street, which lies in the town center. We're on the back side of that. There are a total of 40 horse farms in the town of Granby. And Granby has a very talented and highly sought after wealth of horsemen who reside here as well. Cindy Bonnier has produced national champions in the Morgan horse discipline. She is nationally acclaimed judge and has broke records, breaking prices for her show horses and their offspring. Shayna Humphrey, as we just mentioned, is Olympic level rider of hunter and jumper horses. Her family operates at Lucky Horse Farm we just talked about on Taylor Street. She's nationally rated as a judge of hunter, jumpers, and quarter horses. In addition to nationally noted professionals, Granby has over 30 boarding stables that offer various levels of care and emphasis. It is estimated that each horse brings nearly $8,000 of revenue into the local economy each year. This makes the horse business in Granby to be valued at well over $2 million per year. The Granby Regional Horse Council is a nonprofit organization dedicated to preserving open space for horses in Granby. They are currently involved in numerous projects to preserve and enhance the riding experience in town. They are also involved on a national level with many of the trail preservation and open space organizations for horses.
Right here we have a donkey rescue. And it's a national organization, but this is a division. This is a local part of that organization. And what they do is they take in and foster donkeys, and they try to get them out and fostered. And here you see a couple of the animals that are currently part of the Granby Rescue. So if you like a donkey and you want to foster a donkey that normally, just like dogs, you want to rescue dogs, well, this organization helps to rescue the donkeys. Maybe you need a grass mower in your yard.
We've got Belchertown Police here, and their chief of police is Chris Ponrevost, who used to be an officer in Granby.
And here are the Belchertown Twirlers. The Belchertown Twirlers are proud to be celebrating their 25th anniversary in 2017. The Belchertown Twirlers are the current Massachusetts State Twirling Champs and the Northeast Regional Twirling Champions. Highlights of twirling with Belchertown Twirlers in recent years include performances at Universal Studios in Orlando, the 4th of July Parade in D.C., Macy's Thanksgiving Parade in New York, and Macy's Holiday Parade at Universal Studios. Belchertown Twirlers had the experience of a lifetime in 2010 when invited to perform on a Carnival cruise ship. Belchertown Twirlers have been invited and have performed at the Boston Celtics games and Harlem Globetrotter games.
And the Three County Fairs advertising their Labor Day weekend, one of the longest running agricultural fairs in New England.
It's celebrating did just celebrate their 200th anniversary, and they have plenty of activities up there. It starts late August, I think it's the 31st, through September 3rd.
And there's, just drove by, is David Pelzar, who is proud of his 1946 Case Model D1 tractor, followed by no name here for a nice John Deere tractor.
And a
I'm
nice
not sure
umbrella
if it's Brian
covered.
Mozio's,
yeah.
McCormick W. Farmall. And we have an Over the Hill Gang Auto Club selection of antique and classic cars. This is a souped up hot rod. We got a Chevy Chevelle. Let's see. We have a lot of wonderful participants in today's parade. We probably only take these cars out during days when there's no rain or
when
salt on the
yes.
highways.
Yes, they like nice smooth pavement to keep their cars in working order. That's an old, what is that?
I don't think it's a Studebaker. I can't think of the name of that car.
Pierce Darrow?
No.
No? No? I'm not good with my old car names. I just love them, though. The big balloon tires and the big
steering
wheel.
I believe that's a 38 Buick, and the front one was a 38 Plymouth Coupe with Leo Martin in it, and the Buick Special was Rich Ivanecki. And here's the Sheriff's Department.
Sheriff Patrick J. Callahan immigrated to the United States from Ireland.
Yeah. And our first responders from South Hadley, as our military branches are the first line of defense against harm from world injustice, our fire, EMS, and police departments are the first responders for our communities. The fire personnel who save us from harmful events, the police who enforce the laws and help promote safety, the medical EMS personnel who are the first link to survival with their medical skills. We honor and recognize these women and women for all they do as first responders. We support the dedication of these men and women who perform their duties for our freedom. Beautiful float. And we've got the Belchertown Fire Department, Chief Ted Bach. They have been in existence since around 1900. And they have a new firehouse that was built in 1997. Thank
Isn't
you for our neighbors showing up.
Truck.
Beautiful. And this is the organic tomato festival, famous organic farm from the other side of town, Red Fire Farm. 3 miles. There's a sign right here and indicating the directions to get there.
And every year he has that tomato festival with complete with a run and tasting and various other activities.
And we've got the Leverett Fire Department with Chief John Ingram. Not sure when it was established, but Leverett itself dates back to 1774 when it successfully petitioned the state for separation from Sunderland, who happens to be turning 300 next weekend. Was named for John Leverett, an early governor of Massachusetts who stood strongly against religious persecution and British rule.
Next, we have the Hampshire County Sheriff's Department. Sheriff Patrick J. Calhoun immigrated to the United States from Ireland when he was 10 years old, and his family settled in Northampton, where Patrick attended the local schools. He graduated from the former St. Michael's High School in Northampton and then attended Westfield State, where he got a master's at Western New England after the bachelor's at Westfield State.
And coming down the road here is
some of the vehicles of the Hampshire Sheriff.
Yeah. And beyond that, we have Mark's Garage, who we have to wish a happy 40th anniversary to in September of this year. A great amount of time to be in business, 40 years. And of course, we have to apologize. We've got our fourth list a couple of minutes before the start of the parade, so we've had things in a little bit of different order, but
different
we're trying
order,
to do the
yes.
best job we can so you can enjoy this coverage of Granby's 250th, and happy 250th to Granby. And it looks like all of the patrons on the side of the highway are having a good time today, and we really appreciate the weather cooperating with us today.
And I think, is that also Mark's
Yes, it's
garage?
Also Mark's Garage, yes.
He has an assortment of wreckers on a flatbed that he uses in his business as well.
It keeps them rolling.
He does.
Keeps them busy.
And he has some very interesting vehicles on his property. I know during the Christmas season he lights up an old wrecker
yes.
on the side of the
yes.
road.
Very unique. And of course he's a retired part-time fire policeman in town as well.
Now that's a wrecker, towing a wrecker, towing a wrecker, towing
and
a wrecker.
And as any small towns, his wife is the president of the Historical Society, and she does the bookkeeping for that business.
Very nice showing for Mark's Garage.
And we've
and
got
I
a nice
believe we have Brett which is Terry Johnson's grandson driving his tractor, or one of the tractors, at
Massey
Parker.
Harris. Nice. Ed Parker's,
Ed Parker's
old Massey
old
Harris. Wonderful.
Old tractors, yes. I think this is Brett's brother also driving. These, I believe, are the collection of the Parker tractors.
Who was president of the Mass Maple Syrup Association and a former select man in town, and very much part of Granby history.
And his grandkids are very proud to be driving his tractors today.
And that is just a wonderful display for people that haven't seen the older tractors. They you can't kill them. They're built like tanks.
Yes.
Not as many bells and whistles on them as the modern ones have cages with air conditionings and radios and DVD players, but that's the old-fashioned tractor. No cab. You're in the weather with the like a horse would be.
Yes. And as we mentioned before, Granby is very into horses, and this is the Granby Regional Horse Council. And they run different horse show events at Dufresne's Park from time to time. And I believe there isn't probably a person in Granby that hasn't been through 4-H and gone on to the Granby Regional Horse Council. Look at the steppers, yes, and the little Surrey. Look at the horse steppers. Wow. Beautiful. That's knowing how to ride a horse.
That's talent.
And getting them to perform as you want them to perform. Yes. And there's the pooper scooper for those three. Look at him do the tricks. Back him up, sidestep. Bet you they love to perform.
And at
too.
The end of any parade, you have your refuse company,
yes.
Waste Management of South Hadley, Mass. Of course, they're nationwide, probably the nation's largest
waste
management
yeah.
company. And we've got the street sweeper in case the horse people miss something.
Yes.
That take pride in your drive. That looks like an older sweeper from probably the 70s or 80s. It's from James Keekska Jr. in Hadley, Mass. And we've got more sweepers. It looks like a asphalt patcher.
Yeah, this is your parade cleanup crew right here. Isn't
asphalt
that
patcher. That looks like a Keekska from Granby driving as well.
Very nice. Yeah.
We got lots of lines.
Top gun.
And another sweeper.
And we're coming up on the end of our parade here.
And there's Micheline Turgeon, who did a wonderful job with her committee putting this parade together. Of course, it was not as large as 1968, where there was 30,000 to 40,000 people and much more people. But society has changed, Terry. So I think for
modern day,
I think yes. with the advent of computers and the internet, people are less interested in the community. They're more interested in perhaps that type of information. But for a small town, I thought this was wonderful.
Very nice. And now all of these vehicles are going up the remainder of 202. There's still plenty of people down along 202 in front of Dufresne's Park, where we are currently running our charter days.
Right, and last night they had a wonderful fireworks extravaganza. Friday night they had truck pulls. They had
tractor pulls, I think.
Amusement rides. It's the usual, but it was a little bigger than normal this year because of the 250th. And the weather held out very nice for that weekend of events, as well as the all-class reunion, Founders Day all-class reunion up in Hadley that was held yesterday. That was a very big success. Probably 272 people to eat, and maybe another couple 150 that showed up in and out to say hello to their classmates. All in all, a great time.
So we want to thank everybody for coming out.
And give hand to our camera people. We've got directing is our executive director of GCAM, which is Tricia Woods. On the camera is Alex LaMarche, who was a production coordinator for GCAM. His grandfather, great-grandfather, is the Golden Cane citizen of the town, Gordon Davey. And my wife, Mona, helped out with a camera as well as refreshments for us. And we appreciate the job the crew did today. And on behalf of Granby Community Access and Media, we want to thank you very much for, and we hope you enjoy this telecast. Terry, anything you'd like to say to folks?
No, just history is a wonderful thing. And I think the older you become, the more you realize how important it is.
Right. And when we do complete this coverage, dubs will be available of the DVD of the